and this is Public Broadcasting. I'm your host, Captain Rutlidge, and you might be wondering where the uniform is this month. However, my brown wool suit really plays a good part in today's episode. You see, back in January of 2011, Americans were introduced to the world of Downton Abbey on PBS's Masterpiece Classic. By February of that year, viewers across the country were completely engrossed in the goings-on of the Crawley family and their servants at their stately country home. After the sixth series, viewers thought that would be the last of the Crawley family chronicles, until this year, when a full-length theatrical motion picture is hitting theaters across the country. In honor, I think it would make sense to look back at America's most favorite British drama, Downton Abbey.
Starting in April of 1912 and finishing in January 1926, Downton Abbey follows the life of the Crawley family at their home seat in the country house of Downton Abbey. Lord Grantham is head of the family with his American wife, Lady Cora Crawley, and his mother, the Dowager Countess. Their three daughters, Lady Mary, Lady Edith, and Lady Sybil, dabble in romance and heartbreak while drama occurs with the colorful downstairs staff, Mr. Carson the butler, Mrs. Hughes the housekeeper, and the other staff, including the cunning and devious Thomas Barrow and the equally conniving O'Brien, the resourceful valet Mr. Bates, the reliable maid Anna, and the sharp-tongued Mrs. Patmore, and meek Daisy in the kitchens.
Whew, that's a lot of characters. Over six seasons, we follow the drama of the Crawley family and their staff in the stately country home of Downton Abbey. Just a few of the highlights of these six seasons.
Season 1, Titanic sinks with Lord Grantham's heir and Lady Mary's fiancé as casualties. New heir is Matthew Crawley, a distant cousin. Lady Mary gets into trouble with a Turkish diplomat. Mr. Bates and Barrow are at odds. War is declared in 1914. Season 2, Barrow and Lady Sybil work at an army hospital, while Matthew and the footman William fight in the trenches. Downton is soon converted into a convalescent home. Bates' wife is blackmailing him with the Turkish diplomat incident. Sybil falls in love with the family's new Irish chauffeur, Tom Branson. Matthew and William return from trenches wounded. Matthew is crippled. William is on his deathbed but marries Daisy before passing away. War ends in 1918. Bates' wife is found dead. Anna and Bates marry before Bates goes to prison. Branson and Lady Sybil elope. Matthew proposes to Lady Mary. Season 3, start of Roaring Twenties. Bates is in prison. Matthew and Mary get married. Lord Grantham loses his fortune in bad investments, but breaks even through an inheritance from Matthew. Branson and Sybil return from Ireland. Anthony Strallan proposes to Lady Edith, but leaves her at the altar. Lady Sybil gives birth to a daughter, but dies afterward. Anna discovers Bates' wife poisoned herself, gets an alibi, and Bates returns to Downton. After a holiday in Scotland, Mary gives birth to a son. Matthew is killed in a car accident. Season 4, family cousin Lady Rose comes to live at Downton. Lady Mary courts new suitors. Anna is raped by the visiting Mr. Green. Bates finds out, and Mr. Green is found dead in London. Lady Edith courts Michael Gregson, but Gregson goes missing in Germany. She later gives birth to a daughter. Lady Rose has her coming out in London, and the Crawleys foil a plot to humiliate the Prince of Wales. Season 5, Edith's daughter is adopted by a local farmer. Downton sets up a war memorial. Barrow saves Lady Edith from a fire. Police connect Bates to Green's death. Lady Rose marries Atticus Aldridge. Anna gets arrested under suspicion of Green's death. Lord and Lady Grantham allow Edith's daughter to live in Downton Abbey. Mr. Molesley and Baxter find Bates is innocent, and he returns to Downton along with Anna. Tom and daughter Sibby leave for America. Season 6, Carson and Mrs. Hughes get married. Tom and Sibby return from America. Lady Mary courts Henry Talbot, and Lady Edith courts Bertie Pelham. Neville Chamberlain has dinner at Downton, where Lord Grantham suffers a burst ulcer. Tom and Mary take over his duties. Henry gets into a racing incident, but survives. Mary breaks off their engagement. Bertie Pelham inherits a peerage, but his engagement to Edith is broken off after hearing about her illegitimate daughter. Mary and Henry reconcile and marry. Bertie and Edith renew their engagement. Bertie and Edith get married at Downton on New Year's Eve. Carson decides to retire, leaving Barrow as the new butler. Anna gives birth to a son, and the whole household toasts the new year, 1926. The series was the brainchild of Gareth Neame and Julian Fellowes. Neame had the idea of an Edwardian drama series, and Fellowes had won an Academy Award for writing the murder mystery Gosford Park. Downton was originally going to be a spin-off of Gosford Park, but soon it became a standalone series. Highclere Castle in Hampshire was chosen as the setting of Downton Abbey, with the village of Downton portrayed by the Cotswold village of Bampton in Oxfordshire. Railway scenes were filmed at the Bluebell Railway in Sussex, and London scenes were filmed in the St. James area of the city.
Strange, really. The series explicitly states that Downton Abbey is in Yorkshire, but nearly every scene is shot in the south of England. To be honest, I don't blame them. Yorkshire has a reputation of cold wind and rain, as opposed to the more temperate climates of southern England. I speak from experience.
While the series is anchored to Downton, events from the outside world play a big role in the series at large. For instance, the plot of the first episode deals with the sinking of the Titanic in 1912, and all of the second series takes place during World War I. The passage of 14 years can be seen through the change of costume from the constricted, corseted fashions of the Edwardian era to looser, liberating fashions of the Roaring Twenties.
What's more, I'm feeling somewhat of a deja vu feeling around here. As if PBS and ITV had done all this before. A series showing an aristocratic family and their servants living from the Edwardian era through World War I and the 1920s.
Despite Downton being an original series, it does bear a huge number of similarities with the earlier ITV series Upstairs Downstairs. While Downton attempted more equal screen time for servants and aristocrats, Upstairs Downstairs was more focused on the lives of the downstairs servants. Downton kept a more or less regular cast for its run, while Upstairs Downstairs could kill off characters at a moment's notice.
Could there possibly be copying involved in the ITV writing rooms? I myself say that's not so. I mean, look at American television for a moment. See, in the 1960s and 70s, two Western TV shows aired on NBC, Bonanza and The High Chaparral. Both involved families of cattle ranchers during the days of the Old West, and ABC had a similar premise in the Big Valley, as did CBS with Lancer. My point is, for the American audience, Westerns are a mainstay of television viewing. The same is true for British and costume dramas. But comparisons aside, what is exactly the draw of Downton Abbey?
One word, characters. Series writers made the characters of the show relatable for viewers while still having well-rounded personalities and characteristics. Lord Grantham is a strict, conservative patriarch, but still loving husband and father to his daughters. Mary, Edith, and Sybil follow the usual sibling dynamics, but are nonetheless dynamic in their conquest for love and romance. The same can be said downstairs. Audiences become fond of Bates and Anna, while despising Thomas and O'Brien. And what viewer out there didn't like the Dowager Countess?
I'm afraid the war has made old women of us both.
Oh, I wouldn't say that, but then I always keep out of the sun. So put that in your pipe and smoke it. Don't be defeatist, dear. It's very middle class.
There's nothing simpler than avoiding people you don't like. Avoiding one's friends, that's the real test.
Why does every day involve a fight with an American?
What is a weekend?
By and large, though, the most dynamic character in the series is that of Downton Abbey itself. The house has served to form every character throughout the series as they strive to uphold the reputation of the household, servant and aristocrat alike. The cast of Upstairs Downstairs had to merely worry about the family's prestige, but the cast of Downton had to uphold the prestige of a centuries-old family estate, along with the family that has presided within its walls. It makes for engaging drama and excellent viewing.
There's not much I can say about Downton Abbey that others have said already. American audiences hadn't seen anything like it on PBS since Brideshead had revisited. We've laughed, cried, and cheered on the Crawleys, their servants, and their friends at every turn. The program didn't outstay its welcome, and left the airwaves on good terms. Now, with this new theatrical film, we're going back to the world of Downton once again, but again, six series on television, so what possibly could they follow up the series with when they ended on such a satisfying ending? Well, there's only one way to find out. Come with me.
the West Point Community Theater. The building itself was built around 1910, but only recently was it refurbished for the showing of movies within the community of West Point, along with a few community plays. In a way, its story does seem a bit similar to that of Downton Abbey, a fine building once in decay, but now refurbished to its former glory and becoming a pride to the community. Pretty soon, they're going to be showing a film version of Downton Abbey, which brings to the question, how is the film going to remain fresh after six series of the television series? Perhaps they'll answer a few questions. Maybe Tom Branson will remarry. Perhaps Mary and Edith aren't too happy with their current relationships. Maybe Moseley and Baxter will get together. Who knows? But it's up to the writers to keep the whole film fresh and to add another great conclusion to an otherwise excellent film and TV series. Now, time once again for the local PBS spotlight. And I don't have the paper slips with me. No matter, I'll just pick one at random. Well, looks like we're going to go over to Wyoming for a bit with Wyoming Public Television.
Before Wyoming had its own PBS station, it relied on Nebraska, Denver, and Salt Lake City for public broadcasting. In 1983, the flagship station KCWC-TV received its place on Channel 4, making Wyoming one of the last states in the nation to have its own PBS station. Wyoming PBS is operated out of Central Wyoming College and produces a good number of local programs, including documentaries, political discussions, and farm reports, along with Main Street Wyoming, showing the interesting tidbits of the state. A number of Native American Affairs programs are also produced for the Wind River Reservation outside Riverton. Today, Wyoming PBS is one of the nation's smaller PBS stations, but still offers a wealth of informative and enriching programming for one of the nation's least populated states. If you're in Wyoming, you can tune in to Wyoming PBS on these stations with Create TV on the .2 channel and PBS Kids 24/7 on the .3 channel.
Well, thanks for watching, folks, and I hope you enjoyed this video. If so, feel free to like, subscribe, and share. Also, leave a comment below. And don't forget to support your local PBS station so more programming related to this one can survive on the air. It's about showtime, so in the meantime, I'm Captain Rutlidge. Good day.
Oh, golly, is this thrilling.
If I touch it, will I get a shock?
You'll only get a shock if you listen to it.